Watching EVH Gear TV, brought to you by Design 39 Media. Visit design39media.com for all your website, photography, and video production needs. Microphones for EVH Gear TV are provided by Rode Microphones, and official Van Halen merchandise is provided by VanHalenStore.com. Now, here's your host from Ontario, Canada, EVH Gear artist Eric Broadbent.
Hey everyone, it is a weekend. It's a crappy weekend here in Ontario, Canada. It's probably a crappy weekend. A lot of places that are getting snow, but it's a weekend and Warren Hughes and I are here to hopefully warm up your weekend for you and send you off on your way, whether you're out and about or just snuggling home with the family for the weekend. It's our job to warm you up. And I think with this guest tonight, Warren Hughes, man, I think we're going to warm up the people's weekend. How are you doing, buddy?
I'm all right, man. What's up? Hey, everybody. Been kind of waiting on this.
I know. I'm very happy to have you. You know what? We're going to be treated tonight by some great guitar playing from you. There's no doubt about that. And everyone that's coming in to watch the show tonight knows that. However, like I was saying to you off the air, it's nice to have great conversation with people too. And just, I get this kind of sense from you, people like yourself, Jay Palmer, another example, this positive, just happiness. And I think we need to just kind of relax a little bit and enjoy some of these things. Like I say, you're a great conversationalist, and I think we're going to have a lot of fun tonight and going to kick
it
off.
No doubt.
Yeah. So what's it like your weather, your way right now? We're in the same time zone, but where are you at?
I'm actually in Morgantown, West Virginia. Right now it's about 34, 35 degrees. It's clear skies out. You can see the stars.
Okay.
It's cold, you know, mm-hmm. According to some people, it's cold. It's not cold to me, but you know, that's what it is.
Yeah. So, I'll tell you one thing. I posted this on Facebook and I don't think you saw it. You may have, I don't know, but I posted this before going live. I said, always us guys, always listen to your ladies. Okay. Or your spouse or whoever it is. Listen to your better half. We'll say that.
Right.
And I told you, I was late. You and I were going to do a test call at, what time did we say? 7?
Right. Exactly. Yeah,
right.
Exactly.
So, yeah, I'm notorious for this, and I'm notorious for not listening to my lady. I respect her, but I always think I know the right way to do things, right? And she says, don't take the car out tonight. And it's horrible. Like our town is shut down from snow. And I'm like, wow. I'm a pro driver, right? I'm driving a Camaro. I'm a pro driver. I get uptown, and I'm stuck. And literally stuck. And so I had to call her and say, I'm stuck. And I said, please don't tell me I told you so. You know what I mean?
Right, no doubt. Yeah.
Always listen to your lady.
We don't like to eat that humble pie.
You know? Yeah, yeah. So I said, dear, you're right. So I texted you and said, I'm sorry, man. We're going to be late for the test call. But we're back. We're warmed up. You're warmed up because I saw your Facebook live broadcast moments before the show. That was cool. What were you doing? Some mom scene and some docking?
Yeah, I mean, that's where I kind of, you know, that's kind of where I kind of laid my head, you know.
Nice.
What I mean, you know, growing up in the 80s, you know, I really started seriously playing when I was probably about 17.
Okay.
My uncle took me to, we're just going to get into it. I'll play
some
here in a bit.
Oh, of course. Yeah, that's good.
You know, I got like stories after a while. But,
oh, I love stories, man.
I come from a very small coal town called Osage, West Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
You know, very small. I mean, the coal mines are all closed now, but it was a very small, close-knit community of everybody was poor.
Yeah. So what's the population?
You know, everybody got along. Everybody helped each other, you know.
Yeah.
Went to church with my grandmother all the time. And she played piano. And my uncle, he was the preacher. He played guitar. So then I had another set of cousins. There's 14 of them, and at least they could play the piano. Every last one of them, at least they could do that. Wow. But, you know, they play guitar, bass, drums, you know, what have you. And when I was a kid, you know, my mom, she sang and played piano. And they had a band where they played, like, you know, they played Earth, Wind, and Fire. They played Journey. They played Van Halen. They played, wow. You know, they played everything. You know what I'm saying? So I was always around the musical instruments. But probably when I was, like, you know, 7 or 8, you know, being that it's the Van Halen's 40th anniversary of the first album, you know,
tomorrow.
I remember going to the music store, to the record store, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
For you, all of you guys that don't remember record stores.
That's but, a lot. But
I went to the record store with my uncle. My uncle was, like, really into, like, you know, Deep Purple and Rainbow and, you know, and stuff like that. You know, Journey and Heart and, you know what I'm saying, Foghat and Thin Lizzy, and I could go on and on. But he bought the first Van Halen album, and he bought Kiss Alive 2. Of course, I liked the Kiss Alive 2 because it was, I'd never heard anything like that, and I'd never seen anything like that. But, you know, I remember him putting, he had the 1970s, the real big headphones, you know.
Like this.
Yeah. They were freaking huge. I was a little kid, so they were, like, out to here.
But that's popular again today. That's popular again today.
Right.
Yeah.
But he, you know, I think Eruption was playing. And he put those headphones on my ears. And it just, it blew my freaking mind. You know what I mean? It just blew my mind. And I listened to it over and over and over and over. Then I heard the opening riff to, let's see. You know, I heard that, man. I was just like, oh my God, that's the, you know, that's a sick ass riff.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it was right then. It was instantaneous, you know. It was instantaneous right there. I wanted to play guitar, you know. But being from a very religious, you know, background with my grandmother and everything, I remember, you know, the Kiss Alive 2 came with some tattoos in it.
Yeah.
And I had the Gene Simmons tattoo on my arm, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And she made me wash it off before I went to church, you know. That's the devil's music, you know.
Of course, yeah. But, there'd be some resistance with Kiss, for sure.
So then, as I got older, I didn't really get to play guitar until I was probably about, you know, really start taking it serious till I was like 17. I was in high school, and I kept in rotation on the school bus in high school. I had, let's see, Back for the Attack by Dawkins.
Nice.
Edge of Insanity. I mean, no. Maximum Security by Tony McAlpine.
Nice.
The Van Halen 1, you know, cassette tape.
Yeah.
And the Yngwie Malmsteen Odyssey album. So that's what I listened to all throughout high school. Now, my uncle flew me out to Spokane, Washington, the summer of 88. And that was during the Monsters of Rock tour.
Mm-hmm. Saw that tour.
This was the first concert I ever went to in my life. Never did the first, you know. I mean, you know, I kind of, you know, my uncle rented me a guitar that summer. He rented me a Kramer Stryker 100ST and a Rockman Soloist.
Perfect.
I really didn't know how to play it, you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
I was just making up stuff, but, you know, he took me to that concert, and I saw George Lynch, and I saw Eddie. You know what I mean? And, of course, I mean, I saw the Scorpions, too, which was fabulous. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? It was a great production. You know what I mean? But, you know, after seeing Eddie, you know what I mean? I remember watching Live Without a Net the night before the concert. You know what I mean? And mm-hmm. just, you know, I've just always been, I've always been a fan. You know what I mean? I think I heard Women and Children first before I heard Van Halen 2.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So more so for me, Van Halen 1, the first album, and Women and Children first were really influential. But then after that concert, I had to fly back to Virginia because that's where I was living at the time. And I asked my uncle, I said, can I keep this Kramer guitar and this Rockman or whatever? He's like, yeah, nice. I'll go ahead and buy it for you.
Nice.
And when I went home, man, my friends did not see me. I stayed in my room and I played and I played. I didn't know how to read music. I didn't, you know what I mean? I would just listen to cassettes and try to pick up, you know, what I was hearing. And, you know, just like I do now,
mm-hmm.
same thing. You know, I hear certain things and I'm playing what I think I hear. Not so much that it's the correct way to play it, you know, but I'm playing what I think I'm hearing, like on a CD or what have you now. So those are kind of like my beginnings as far as, you know, playing, man. It was just, you know, like I said, that first Van Halen album was, you know, it's still I still listen to it today, you know, and it still sounds the freaking same.
Timeless.
It hasn't lost
timeless
any of its luster.
That's
you
right.
You know what I mean? So.
Several things that you said there I really like. Number one, you say earlier in the program, you said, you know, you come from a poor town, the town's a poor town, and you come back to the town with some nice toys that, you know, thanks to your uncle, got a guitar, got a, you know,
right.
the Rockman, a processor. And, you know, for parents that are worried about their kids getting into trouble, you know, on the streets, you know, it's slightly different today than it was, you know, when you and I were kids, but it's still,
right.
there's trouble out there that people can get into if they're idle hands, right?
Absolutely.
So parents, invest in your children's future as far as music. Like, obviously focus on schooling as a, you know, first and foremost.
Right.
I mean, just like a sport, you might make it into the NFL, you might make it to NHL, and you break a knee or break a leg, or and you're out, and then you got no education to fall on, you're done. Same thing with music.
Right.
You might make it tomorrow. It's the odds today are much higher or much less that you're ever going to make it.
Absolutely.
But you could make it, but always make sure there's an education, you know, a foundation to fall back on. Like some of these rockers, look at, you know, we were joking about this in some of the shows. Some of these guitar shredders are actually lawyers and things like that. So if the
right.
band falls apart, there's something to fall back on. But I really like the fact that, you know, one, you come back home, and unfortunately, your social life takes a back seat because you don't get to have all the friends and stuff like that. Because Eddie was the same thing as a kid, you know,
right.
And especially a teen, you know, the friends would be calling him, hey, Eddie, want to go out and go on the party town or whatever? No, I'm here practicing the guitar.
Right.
And, you know, that's what happens. If you want to be good at what you pursue, there are some sacrifices.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And that was one thing I never had to worry about. You know, my mom, you know, she never came in my room and said, turn that down. It's late at night.
Wow.
Not one time. She was just so happy because I was never a good student.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to be upfront. You
yeah.
know, I wasn't that good student that made good grades and no. things of that nature. So my mom was just happy that I found something, you know what I'm saying, that I was interested in, and that, you know, I wasn't going to just leave by the wayside. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And, you know, and then it got to the point where I had friends would come over and stay all night and bring their guitar and bring their amp. And we'd sit back in my room and play. And she never complained one time. She never, ever said, turn that down. It's 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. It was never like that.
I love that.
You know what I mean? So that even more, that pushed me even more to want to, you know what I'm saying? And then, you know, she started going to, and this is where this comes in. She started going to the music stores with me. I actually used to go to a music store called Music City. It was in Woodbridge, Virginia.
Okay.
It was on Route 1, and there was a bass player. His name was Dave Krieger. He's he played with the Michael Fath band. I don't know if you're familiar with Michael Fath.
No, I'm not. I'm sorry.
But Michael Fath was like he was a shredder around the D.C. area,
okay.
Maryland and Virginia. And he was pretty, you know, he was pretty well known back, you know, in the time. But, you know, Dave Krieger, he played bass. He ended up going to play with Foghat.
Oh, wow.
But a lot of these guys, and like Mike Himmel gave lessons at this store. And that's how I met Mike Himmel. This is back in 89 or so. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So Mike Himmel was the first guy I ever saw, you know, play all that Van Halen and Dawkins. And he was hitting it note for note. And this is, you know. This was back then.
Yeah, when it was basically being released.
Right. He was just freaking ridiculous with it. You know what I mean? He was the first guy I saw that could play all that stuff. And I was like, Mom, I want to take lessons from this guy. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So yeah, there was a couple of times I didn't have money for lessons, man. Mike would be like, man, don't worry about it. He was like, man, you got something. You know, he told me then, he's like, you have something that all these kids do not have. You already have it. You know what I'm saying? You just have to, you know, you got to sit down and basically, you know, you got to practice stuff. You know
mm-hmm.
what I'm saying? But as far as talent, he was already like, you know, he would tell people, you know, Warren's playing stuff that I know guys been playing 20 years. They can't play the stuff that he's playing. He's only been playing a year.
Yeah, and he probably saw
you know
the passion
I mean?
That you had as well. He recognized that passion. Passion can you either have it or you don't. You can't
right.
learn passion. You have to be. You have to have that from the get go. So passion, and then of course the talent that you had. The two and two go hand in hand, and look where that brought you.
Absolutely. But yeah, man, I was just always there was something about me being around talent all the time, and you know that helps too. It helps being around players. That'll blow you out of the water, man.
You have
because
to.
That gives you some that gives you some aspirations to, you know what I'm saying? Want to be, you know, on that pedestal as well.
Yes.
You know what I mean? So I was always around good players. And like around here, around, you know, Pittsburgh and things like that, there's a player named Jim Dofka. You know what I mean? I've known him for over 20 years, you know? Mm-hmm. And when I first saw him play, man, there was just something about this kid, man. He was just freaking awesome. You know what I mean? And, we still keep in touch today, you know? And I don't know if you've ever seen The Mad Drummer.
No.
But The Mad Drummer, he's from this area too, but he played in the band with this guy.
Oh, wow.
So these guys were they were awesome back in the late 80s, early 90s.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? There just wasn't any YouTube or Facebook.
Yeah, you had to make them famous,
yeah. You know
what I
mean? So, but yeah, man, I just always try to go around talent.
Mm-hmm.
And even now, you know, I look at some of these kids, I'm inspired by, you know, some of the younger generation.
Oh, I guarantee you on that.
You know, I mean, because there's some of these kids that, you know, there's some of the kids that, you know, are, you know, they're sitting on YouTube and they're watching stuff. And then there's some that actually, you know, have the talent.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? And I can separate the two.
Oh, of course.
I can hear it.
Yep.
You know, and there's a few out there, man, that are just, you know, they're killing it.
I know.
And I tell them, you know, I'm inspired by what you do.
Yep.
You know, I'm never that great or never on top that much.
No.
I can't give out credit where credit is due, man. You know, if something moves me, I'm going to let you know it moves me.
Just because you're their senior, because you're older than them, you've been playing decades longer than they have, does not mean that you can't be inspired. We are inspired by all different, everybody, people that are older than us, people that are younger than us.
But right.
One thing I want to say, I just mad respect to your mom. I mean, that's awesome. And I'll just share a personal small story. So,
sure.
And I think our moms would have loved each other. Same idea too. When I was first starting, I was making some, you know what it's like when you're first starting guitar and you really don't know any notes. You don't know notes at all. You're just making noise. You got distortion, you
right.
make noise. And it would be the most horrendous sound. Like if I actually heard it right now, if I heard Junior playing that, the noise I was making, I would probably almost
right.
like have a vein pop out of my forehead. It was that bad. But my mom would be washing dishes in the kitchen. It was almost like it was a music box or a lullaby for her. She just absolutely loved it. And
right.
there again too, never complained. So,
right.
I mean, you know, people listening to this can call you and I mama's boys if they want. Bring it on. I don't care. If it wasn't for
right.
our moms, we would not be talking here today about how much we love guitar and the instrument. So that's number one. So mad respect to your mom. And is your mom still with us?
No, she passed 1990.
1990. Very sorry to hear that.
Yeah.
We're going to talk about some other family members that you've lost too later on in the program.
Sure.
So very sorry that you lost her. And how about your dad? Do you have your dad or no?
No, he passed when I was 14.
Oh, dude, man. Yeah.
He was a musical genius, man.
Really?
I mean, I've posted some pictures on Facebook of he had a drum and bugle corps when I was like 6 years old.
Nice.
So at 6 years old, I was playing the bugle and marching in parades, and you know what I mean? It's just the music's always been there inside of me, man.
I love that.
You know what I'm saying?
Deep in the roots
so
of your family.
This is a testament to both my parents and my brother. You know what I mean? He was a musician. He was a drummer. He recorded an album when he was like 12 on the drums. He was just freaking ridiculous, you know? So but this is all, hey man, like I said before, you know, you go through some things that make you a stronger person.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think I'd be the player that I am right now if I would not have went through those things.
Yeah, loss. There's some losses that kind of shape you as a man
in
your life. And you either become comatose or you're dead yourself. Or
right.
you learn to rebound from that. And because your mom or your dad or your brother in this case would not want you sitting around mourning their loss for the rest of your life in depression. They would want to see you carry on what, you know, they encourage you to do. And, you know, if there's the afterlife and heaven above and all that kind of stuff, whatever you believe in, you know,
right.
I think there's some smiles coming back down on you from your family.
That's for sure, man. That's for sure. And then, you know, I think about my brother, man, because he went to my first show, you know, and I remember him, you know, sitting through the whole show. And he's just standing out there and he's just looking. And, you know, the show's over and he's helping me carry my equipment to my car. And he's like, he turns and looks at me and he's like, man, I had no idea you could play that guitar like that. He's like, I thought you was back in that room making noise all them years. Because the first band I was in, I wrote all the music. I was like, you know, the guitar is pretty vocal as far as, you know, how stuff is going to go. So,
sure.
You know, I had some riffs that I had been playing and I threw some, you know, I didn't throw it together, but,
yeah,
you know, it was a work in progress, you know, as far as, you know, writing songs and putting them together. And, you know, it just happened to come out, you know, and he, like I said, he saw it and heard it. And he was just like, and that was a, you know, that was a big pat on the back for me. You know what I'm saying? Because I thought he, you know, he's a bigger brother, and, you know, the whole bigger brother thing. That's hard to get that respect from your big brother.
I know. You're in the shadows all the time.
So that was probably a big moment in my life as far as me playing. You know, it was just it was crazy.
I was going to ask if it was an older brother or a younger brother. It doesn't really matter, but I do get it. I do get it from an older brother. You know, you get respect from big brother, where you're always trying to be, he's a successful football player, or he's the you know, he's good with the ladies, he's got all the girlfriends or whatever. But
right,
so
right.
You won his like, wow, man, my little brother really rocks. So I can imagine
right.
That moment was pretty surreal for you, and you probably locked that one away for many years.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah.
And that's what, you know, like I said, there's certain things that push you and keep you going. You know what
yeah.
I mean? So that was one of those moments.
I love that.
Go ahead.
I love that. That's fantastic. And I see it here at home as well, too. You kind of watch my life. I watch your life. I mean, you know, that's what Facebook
right.
is, right? We get to snoop on everyone's lives, what they have for dinner.
Right, right, right.
And Junior with me here as well, too. I haven't really given him much instruction.
Right.
I always encourage people that have musical kids or sports kids. If you're
mm-hmm.
if you're into sports, have someone else teach them the sports. Give them some guidance, but have someone else teach them, because I don't think we give our students the best training if we're their parents. That's what I feel. I think someone else
right.
should always do it. We're either too hard on them or too soft on them. And I haven't really given Junior much musical instruction, but
mm-hmm.
he scares the living crap out of me, what he does.
Mm-hmm.
Like
he
put something on YouTube last night. We're in here after, you know, we're jamming in here in the studio. He put something on YouTube. He finds the notes. His ear is impeccable.
Right.
You know, I'm like, holy cow, mm-hmm. kid. I am just so blessed to watch you make music. You know, that's a story for another show, but I'm just so blessed, and I'm going to encourage it. And he told me one day, this is something that made me feel kind of cool as a dad, and maybe not necessarily the best dad when it comes to getting homework done and things like that. Homework's important,
mm-hmm.
but he says, you know what I really like about your dad? We're coming home from school. He says, you know, I know I got homework, but I'll always ask you, can I play my guitar or my bass or my keyboards, whatever, for a little bit? And I'm like, yeah, go ahead and do that now, but make sure you get your homework done tonight. And he's thrilled that he gets to do that, you know?
Right. Yeah, no doubt. I have my son, he plays. He's, Junior is 20, he's 25 now.
And that's Junior.
Yeah, that's Junior.
Wow.
Junior is, he's a good player.
Yep.
You know, he does, you know, you could tell when, he likes it, you know,
mm-hmm.
and he can do it. But you can tell when your kids don't have, you know, the love and determination that you had.
Right.
Whenever you were a kid.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, like for Junior, I show him stuff. And,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's totally up to you how much you practice it if you really want to learn it.
That's right.
You know what I mean? I'm not hard on him. I let him do it at his own pace. You know what I'm saying? And I encourage him. And I let him know, you know, I'm not shy about it. You know, if you want to learn this stuff, you got to practice.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? You know, because when I was doing it, nobody had to tell me.
Yeah.
You know, it was just like, I'm gonna get this right here because I, you know, I like this song. Just like Ain't Talk About Love was a song I always wanted to learn. I always wanted to learn how to play that. I still think that's the coolest riff that was ever made.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know. And I really worked hard, and you know, there were certain people that tried to show me, but you know, I learned probably like three different ways to play that song.
Of course, we all do.
It was so hard that the ways that people were showing me, and it wasn't until I got older to where I kind of understood chord structure a little bit. I'm like,
yep.
Hey, wait a minute, I can play this up here, and don't have to be jumping all up in here and down here and up here and down here. You know what I mean? So
that's what I tell Junior. If you're jumping all the time, chances are you're doing it wrong. You probably
right,
are.
Exactly.
Yep.
Just like with the, I was messing with the fifth caprice here the last couple months.
Mm-hmm.
And once again, I learned it a couple of different ways. And to where I got the point to where I was like, hold on, there has to be an easier way to where I don't have to move so much.
Yep. And it's not laziness. It's not laziness. It's science. It's like, or what's the word? Yeah, it's like, okay, it's unorthodox. If you're going like this to here, it's unorthodox. Yeah, exactly. Now, that may happen like in an Yngwie Malmsteen thing or something, but for the most part, you got to think logistics. And I've seen the guys who do an A, talk about Love Almost, doing like an A minor.
Arpeggio. Minus,
yeah, like Andy Summers.
Like that.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's like,
cool,
like...
but... Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That sounds cool, though.
Some people do. That's where I kind of learned it first, and then I got the...
And see how cool that sounds?
Huh?
And see how cool that sounds right there? That's the right way to do it, right?
That sounds just like the album.
That's right.
And I was always one of those people. I was just like, that has to sound like, you know, just like if I'm doing like I was messing with, what was I messing with the other day? That, what's that Dawkins song? The Hunter.
Okay.
Okay, I'm messing with that the other day, and I'm just like, and I was watching somebody do an instructional video. I was like, no, it don't sound like that.
I know.
You know what I'm saying? And I'm thinking more of all the like a. But you know what I mean? I'm thinking of the way George talks.
Yes.
You know, how he speaks or, you know, all that digging and slurring. And, you know, that's how I hear things. And, I hear people play stuff and they'll like skip over the phrasing portions. I'm just like, no, you can't forget that. That's the language.
I know.
That's what moves people.
That's right.
You know? Yeah, man, it's crazy.
The funny thing is, with all the stuff that you're learning, and we all learn as musicians, and whether we're beginners or intermediate or advanced professionals, the great thing is with YouTube, we can take lessons from people and we can watch what they're doing. But the bad thing is now we get 50,000 versions. And to be honest with you, I don't mean to sound, this isn't negative, but there's no one that does everything exactly right other than the artist who does it. And even that artist that does it right, the Eddie Van Halen's, the George Lynch's, the Yngwie's of that, even they've kind of forgot some of their passages and their embellishments and all that kind of stuff. So even they don't do it right. But, you know, you can, it's like, you know, tablature, God forbid you look up tablature online.
Yeah.
It's like, whoa.
Yeah, exactly.
Did you hear the song actually? Did you actually hear the song right?
Right, exactly. Because this tab don't go nothing like the song goes.
No.
I'm just saying.
No.
This does not fit.
Have you watched that one guy on YouTube? Junior and I like him a lot. Stevie T. He's a Canadian guy.
I don't think so.
He does get all the funny faces and stuff. He plays all the Kiesel guitars and stuff like that. And he did he did a review one time of bad tablature on the internet. And I think it was Queen, Bohemian Rhapsody, and a couple others, whatever. And so he was playing it. And then, so he'd play the tab and then he'd play the guitar part. And it was so horrific. It's like, I think he said something along the lines of, when you tabbed this, did you listen to the song?
Right, exactly.
It was horrible.
I think Blues was talking about that last week.
Yes.
You know, he was talking about how, you know, these guitar players wrote stuff and it wasn't going exactly how they wanted it to.
Mm-hmm.
But they just kind of was like, okay, we're just going to leave it, you know. But I'm pretty sure they didn't play what they really, you know, they didn't say what they really had to say, basically.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, you know, and he was saying how, you know, everybody's playing stuff, you know, basically wrong.
I know.
You know, but like I said earlier, I'm playing what I think I hear.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying?
And how do you measure that as a perfect skill?
And I emphasize the word think.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So
yep, I do 100%.
So I'm not a big you know, go by the book and I had 3 years of classical guitar at West Virginia University.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm gonna tell you right now, that was the most boring shit I probably ever did in my life. Excuse my French.
No, I bet it was. I bet it was.
I'm serious, man. It was just like, you know, go in here, go in here for your lesson for an hour, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to give you this big piece to learn, okay? And then you learn this piece and you come back and play it. I mean, it was just so unemotional.
No inspiration.
No, it's kind of like, I talk about this too. It's kind of like you're a painter,
mm-hmm.
okay? And, you know, you paint a picture and you say, hey, Warren, I want you to add paint inside this line right here. Okay, but you can't go outside this line and you can't paint nothing you want to. Oh. You got to paint exactly what I tell you. You can't use any of your outside influence on this whatsoever. So that was pretty much the whole classical guitar thing as far as being in school and I think the hardest part of playing, going to school for music is, number one, I would have to say the theory was just, it just wasn't sinking in, man. But I found myself, once I learned to read, I found myself playing this stuff, and I'm like, man, I've been playing this for the past 5 years, but didn't know the literary term for it. Right. You know what I mean? So I'd be playing a lot of the minor stuff, and I'd be like, and I would really struggle with it as far as sight reading.
Mm-hmm.
But once I actually got it, you know what I'm saying, and I'd play it, and then I'd play it again, I'd be like, man, I've been playing this for the last 10 years.
Yeah.
You know? And so that was frustrating. You know, so finally I got to the point, and I was just like, you know, this isn't really making any difference of, you know, who I am as a player.
Sure, of course.
Which of course, me being young and, you know, thinking, oh, yeah, I'm going to be like Yngwie Malmsteen if I go to school and learn classical and blah, blah, blah. And it just didn't work that way, man. I was just like, you know what, just forget it. I'm just keep doing what I'm doing.
Yep.
And, you know, whatever comes out of it, comes out of it.
Don't fix what's not broke. And I've said that on the show just even recently, the last couple of nights. The way I try to make it simple for people that, you know, they're just maybe discovering music and getting into it, you know, theory can be like a roadmap. And here again, too, this, for people, the younger generation, they don't even know what a physical roadmap is. Like you and I grew up with, you know, folding out in our parents' car, 10 feet wide, and how to get from here to here. Now, sure, we follow from point A to point B on that roadmap. We'll get there. But what it's kind of fun once in a while, once you've done that trip from A to B a million times, let's take some of the back roads and some of the little side streets.
And see where we end up.
Yeah, apply that with music. Yeah. And it's like, where can we go if we just tried maybe this note that says it's the wrong note? Don't play this note. Don't push that big red button. Right. And look what happens sometimes. Some of the wrong notes or the things people tell you not to do on the instrument can be some of the most beautiful things.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. I've made a lot of mistakes that I'm like, man, I'm keeping that.
Yeah.
You know, or I'll take something like, you know, Eddie has this lick that's something like. Okay.
Yep.
Eddie has a lick like that.
Yep.
I actually took that and used it and just let it.
I like that.
But you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I take little stuff like that and I can use it in a different way. Even though I did, you know, I stole it from Eddie, but.
Sure. But still, but it doesn't necessarily sound like it. And it's funny when you do that because that almost has a flavor. And I know Eddie and George Lynch were on the same path, neck and neck, you know, especially back in that day. And that even has a bit of George flavor to it. I hear that in that right there, too. Obviously, it's been an influence on you, too. But I can hear that, too.
Right, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, man, he I think Eddie's always, I've just always really, really respected Eddie and put him on a pedestal. You know what I mean?
I know.
I've never really learned a whole bunch of his technique. You know what I mean? George was on something just totally different than everybody else out of that era. You know what I mean? So I think that's what kind of drew me towards that.
Mm-hmm.
I always said I wanted to be like, you know, George Lynch, Tony McAlpine, and Yngwie Malmsteen kind of thrown
in a mix
into a bunch. Yeah. You know what I mean? But like I said, I remember getting, remember the Circus magazines? Do you remember those?
Hit Parader, Circus, Cream, all that stuff.
I remember getting like the Circus magazines when I was a teenager.
Yep.
And I would rip out all the Van Halen pictures. This was probably during the US Festival.
Sure.
A lot of the pictures. And, man, I had, like, Van Halen all on my wall. I would go to, like, the record stores when they had the posters. I had, like, the Van Halen 2 with the – he had the Bumblebee guitar. You know what I mean? I was just a fan, you know. And I remember my mom, she bought me a boombox for Christmas. And this was in 1984.
Mm-hmm.
So she bought me the first Van Halen cassette. I've had that thing like 100 times, but because it's, you know, she bought me that. She bought me Journey, Frontiers, and then the day that 1984 came out, she came home from work. She said, "I got you something."
Oh boy!
And you know, she handed me this little bag. You know.
Yeah.
And it was 1984. You know what I'm saying? And I listened to that thing, man. I was just like, "This is the baddest shit I've ever heard about." You know what I mean?
I know.
I was just, you know, she bought me 1984, and I think a pack of gummy bears or something. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, I was the only, you know, little black kid. And, you know, this is in Alexandria, Virginia, because we moved from small town West Virginia to Virginia. And we lived in Alexandria. And it was predominantly, you know, black neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
But I was the only little black kid with a boombox, you know, blasting Van Halen.
Yep.
You know, everybody else was at the time was listening to Run DMC and the Fat Boys.
They're like, what's this kid
all
doing?
The, all the rap stuff doing? Back then. And, you know, I got made fun of. And, you know, when I was by myself outside, I'd, you know, break a stick off a tree and acted like it was a guitar. And I'd do the Van Halen guitar jump thing. Yeah. And, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I cut my jeans up, you know, because Eddie had the jeans with the patches.
Sure.
During the 1984 and all that. So, yeah, man, I was just totally into the whole Van Halen. I still am. You know what I mean? I'm, you know, like I said, he's freaking phenomenal, man. I don't know what else to say.
Well, you know what I admire about you? What I admire about you is you could have been a follower, or you could have been a leader creating your own path, and that's what you did. You could have been listening to the Run DMC, which is great music. No, there's no denying
right,
that.
Right.
But you know what? You didn't go with the flow. It's like, I don't care. This isn't anything different to me. This is just what I like. And here's what I'm going with. And probably people hated you for that because you're different. You're that kid playing. Why is that kid listening to Van Halen? You know, you should be listening to disco or rap or whatever.
Right, exactly.
Stereotype you. But, and that's ridiculous. So kudos to you on that one. Phenomenal.
Yeah, and to make it so bad, man, I still get that on Facebook sometimes.
Oh, yeah.
Man, you get some of these dudes, man. You know, what's a black dude doing playing metal or playing rock or playing this or playing that?
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? And you know, I always take it back to this. Whenever I was a kid and my uncle put that Van Halen on my, you know, he had those big headphones. Mm-hmm. I didn't see what color they were.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? I like the music. You know what I'm saying? And you know, you still have people they can't separate from that.
Oh,
you
know I
know. What
I'm
saying? And it's just like, man, you know, you're totally missing. You're missing the big picture here.
I saw that comment on your Facebook, and I forget who said it. I don't know if it was your reply. Or someone had commented back. And here again, like I was telling you off the air, I can't retell jokes, and I also can't retell stories very well.
Right.
But someone had said, probably one of your friends, you know, music doesn't know colors. Only people know colors. Something like, is that what it was?
Right. But that's the truth, man. It's just like, come on, guys. You know, this is all about vibrations, man.
Mm-hmm.
That's all it's about. It ain't about nothing else but that.
Yeah.
And it's about those vibrations that make you feel good or vibrations that make you think above your 9-to-5 every day or what you think you were put here to do.
That's right.
You weren't put here to do that. You were put here to do something above and beyond what society says.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Yep.
So I think if a lot more people would tap into that, then this place, you know, this world would be a lot better place.
You know, what I think it is, what it comes down to as well, too, is whether you're a musician, a politician, a sports hero. Okay, so maybe and you're looking up to someone, and I admire an athlete, and he's a black athlete, and he can play basketball better than I can, then I hate him because he's better than me. Or if I this guitar player can shred better than me and I'm intimidated by it. I told you this too. This was a comment on your reply as well too. And a lot of people don't know this. You know, I don't mind sharing personal things.
Sure.
But I like to be that fly on the wall when someone wants to try and be, try to play the race card or try to, you know, shut you down for race. And I just sit there and you know, whatever people think I'm Mr. White, whitest man of Canada. Meanwhile, half my family is black. My stepdaughters are black, half black. And so when a comment comes out, what's racial, I'm like, by the way, here, have a look at my daughter.
Right. Exactly.
And I'll say, and then you want to see a white person go whiter? It's freaking hilarious.
Exactly.
So bottom line, whether you're Hispanic, black, white, half this, half that. It's not about the color. It's about what your vocabulary and how you speak. Not always musician, not always music, how you speak as your craft, whatever that may be.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And absolutely, man. And that's the most important thing, man. You know, there's still a lot of people that need to get that, man. Mm-hmm. That was very well said.
Yep.
But it's the truth, man. It's just like, come on, guys. You know, I mean, there's certain powers that be that hate us all.
Oh, of course.
At some point, you know, we're going to have to take up and, you know, stand together. Now, are we going to stand together or are we going to fight over our differences?
That's right. And
so I just.
Yeah, but with politics, we won't go into politics. But the thing is, you know, when the world comes to whatever may, you know, like you say, if it comes down to the bottom line and we all have to survive somehow, okay.
Right.
Well, let's team up. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Let's jump over to the chat for a sec. We got a whole whack of great people in the chat,
and
we'll come back to some questions. We got a lot of your friends in here and some of our regulars here as well, too. Phenomenal lineup in the chat tonight. So we've got Quentin James jumping in saying, hey, Liza Morris is here. Scott MacArthur. Curtis Murata is here. Happy Aloha Friday, everyone. Quentin James saying, Warren. Hi, Warren and Eric from Liza. Greg Mara, we were talking about him off the air. Good things about you, of course. Warren and Eric. And really cool, Greg. Congratulations on the solo guitarist that you're working with there.
Yeah,
very,
no
very
doubt.
Nice guitarist. Very proud of you, man. That's awesome. It's no surprise that you're doing what you do.
Yeah, no doubt.
Steve Mazanko, if I'm, that might be one of your friends, Mazanko. I can't pronounce that properly. Mizanko. Mazanko says, "What's up, Warren?" Eric Gruber is here. Hello to the both of you, Thomas, Santiago. Hello, Eric and Warren, everyone in the chat. Constance is here saying, "Hey, this is Constance's husband, Dave." Hey, Warren, we're in Follansbee, West Virginia. Am I saying that right? Follansbee?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. That's right.
Cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So, kind of somewhat neighbors. And yeah, Liza was saying, lucky fans to say Monsters of Rock. I always get challenged. I challenge myself with the Monsters of Rock. I saw them at the Pontiac Silverdome in Detroit, and I want to just try for a second to recall the lineup. Now, obviously, Scorpions, Van Halen. So, Scorpions, Van Halen, Kingdom Come, Dokken, and High Holy Days. Is that? No, hang on. Was that right?
Metallica.
Well, High Holy Days was a band they played in Canada. Metallica. I'm so right. Embarrassed. I forgot Metallica. Yeah, that little band called Metallica. I forgot about those guys.
Just
a little band, right?
Yeah, those guys.
All right.
But I remember that was like, my uncle even gave me he didn't give it to me, but I'm sure he's going to give it to me at some point. He had that Van Halen necklace. Remember that necklace?
Oh, Teddy, of course. Oh, yeah.
I think he got that from the US Festival. I mean, not the US Festival, but I think he saw them in 83 or so. And he had that necklace. So I put that necklace on and went to the concert, and it was just like, you know, and when I saw George Lynch at NAMM, I said, I remember seeing you the first time play at the Monsters of Rock in Spokane. And he's like, "That's my hometown." I was like,
"No,
I know that's your hometown." You know what I'm saying? But he was a nice dude, man. You know what I'm saying? He was laid back. He was cool. And also, I met Michael Sweet too.
Oh yeah, he's a great guy.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, he was cool. But yeah, man, it's nice to go there. And, you know, sometimes I think to myself, you know, I go around some of these people and I'm like, man, what? Or just like the Amp Show, when I was playing with Greg Mara and Larry Mitchell and, Alan Hines and, you know, all these guys, man. And, you know, we take a picture for the Amp Show and I'm sitting there thinking to myself, what the hell am I doing here with these guys? You know what I'm saying? And, you know, sometimes I have to take my, you know, I have to really sit back and think about that because, you know, a lot of these guys, they've recorded, they've been in the business for years, you know what I'm saying? And here I am. I'm just a guy that, you know, started making videos on freaking Facebook.
But you know what? Those guys, whether they say it verbally or not, they're eventually saying, what the heck am I doing here with Warren Hughes?
Oh, okay.
You know, they say
it that way.
But, seriously, you earn the respect.
Greg Mara is, you know, he's from Pittsburgh. So whenever we talked, you know, we talked about a lot of the same people that we knew, which was very refreshing to be way out there in California. And I had no idea he was from the Pittsburgh area. So, you know, we probably went to a lot of the same shows together. We didn't know each other.
Nope.
You know what I'm saying? So that was refreshing. And of course, you know, his playing is off the chain. I was just like...
It's stupid
good.
And
this dude is freaking crazy.
I know, it's good.
I mean, he's just on a... I don't know, man, just a different level. He's different than I am. You know what I'm saying? You know how you always hear other players play things and you're like, wow. You know, you just automatically, you know, something catches your ear and you're just like, wow. And the first thing I always think is, I can't do that.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Not that they're playing anything super difficult, but it's just
the way they do it.
It's out of what you do personally.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So
in the last 10 years, I've been able to adapt myself to, instead of getting frustrated by hearing someone like you play or Greg or any of these guys that you mentioned, you know, you could be really frustrated and say, I'm done. I'm going to sell my guitar and I'm going to go drive a cab. I may never be able to play like you guys, but I'm inspired by it. You have to find that thing as a person to, how do I turn it off? Where's my filter to balance between I'm frustrated and I hate you, or like, thank you for the inspiration that you're giving me.
Right.
And I think that's what I've adapted myself. I've been like, okay, I can now be inspired by you guys. I'm still never going to play like you, but thank you for what you're giving us.
Right. There has to be this like mutual respect, man.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Because if there's not that mutual respect, then you might as well forget it.
Yeah.
Because you're always going to think, this person here has their nose up in the air, or what have you. You know what I'm saying? So that's why I always, you know what I mean? I try to find a mutual, just like on Facebook, if, you know, you see a lot of people speaking about political things, and you may not necessarily agree with that. Mm-hmm. Or I might say something political, and you might not necessarily agree with it. But I always say this. We are friends because we have something in common.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? So that's where I always break the ice with that whole, you know.
Yeah, of course.
Just like, you know, we had something in common before, you know, I actually knew what you thought.
Yes.
So let's keep it on the,
yep,
we got something in common. You know what, yeah, I mean?
If something I said is really bad, like I have some friends that go really crazy either way, left or right, with political, mm-hmm, things, mm-hmm, and sometimes religion. And honestly, right, I don't care who you believe in for your political leader.
Right.
I don't care who you pray to at night to save you and bless you and things like that. I really don't care.
Right.
I don't usually share too much that way. But if I say something, don't hate me for it. And I'm certainly not going to hate you for it. I might say, ooh, okay, I'm going to stay away from that one. But you're my friend. I'm not going to get involved in that one. And I scroll on down. You know, so that's the way you said it was beautiful. The fact that we were friends before this, and just because we may say something here, I mean, if it was hate speech, well, then that deserves to be unfriended. But not hate speech or racial things, which is hate speech, then it can be accepted. So that it's a really different place for that. And as long as we can all put, you know, check our coats at the door, I think we're going to be in a better place.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, now back to the music.
Yeah, all right, that's perfect. And I'm going to come back to the chat here in a little bit as well, too.
Go ahead.
Actually, just a couple more, because we've got some good people here as well, too. Don Shepard says, good day, this is going to be fun tonight. Warren, love your music. That's from Don. That's awesome. Thanks, Don.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Speaking of great talent, Craig Rendles says, hey Warren, good to see you on the show.
And Craig's cool.
He is. And you know what? I took one for the team. He was here. He was supposed to be scheduled on the Friday of NAMM, the 20, whatever that would be, the 25th, 26th, whatever. And I said, look, you know what? I know you want to be on the show. I want you on the show. I love you on the show. I said, go have some fun at NAMM. You know what it's like, the NAMM after parties and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
Let's get you back on. So Craig, we'll get you back on right away. Whatever works for your schedule, you message me. I wanted him to go have some fun. Isn't that, you know, so there we go. Let me see. Ren Benton says, my dude. That Rene Benton, that must be one of your friends.
Yeah, I know Rene. He's cool.
Nice. Let me see here. Eric Gruber says, music keeps us all out of trouble. Of course, maybe puts us in debt due to gas. Yeah, music can keep us out of trouble sometimes, but gear acquisition can be something that will set us in some financial problems.
Right.
You know?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Eric Gruber, toys, bright, shiny toys. Chris Kerr says, hey, all. Don Shepard says, hey. Okay, so Rene Benton, your friend there, says Michael Fath, I remember him. Craig Rendles agreed, mm-hmm, passion is a driving force of success and everything. So crazy how many of us guitar players had the same childhood, same influences. That's from Craig, and it's true. And
yeah.
I would not know half the people that I know today, yourself included, and all these fine people, guys and girls in the chat, if it wasn't for Van Halen, music in general, but if it wasn't for Van Halen, I would probably have about four friends on Facebook, and we, you know, we certainly wouldn't be talking about music. So it's awesome. You're very well said, Craig. Jeffrey Monroe says, amen, brother. Eric Gruber says, good music is good music, period. FNAF Gamers is one of our younger fans, is jumping in saying, hey. Ken McMahon is one of your friends here, says, hey, Warren, Craig Rendles, my mom does not know what I look like without a guitar around my neck. I love that. That's priceless, man. Yeah. AI Gaming says, I found out about Dave Simpson on YouTube. The guy is phenomenal. One of the best guitarists I've seen in my life, and I'm old. Quentin James was got one of the best comments of the entire night. Mom's rule. That's very true.
No doubt.
Jay's Tacos and Guitars, another amazing artist with amazing stories. And I told you, he's not just a great guitar player. He's a great conversationalist. Craig Rendles, mm-hmm, says, I should qualify the statement by saying I am in my late 40s. And she... and she's in her late 80s, so she might be forgetting a little bit, but still, we'll go with the original story. That's pretty good, Craig. Don Shepard saying, hey, Jay. And you know what we're going to do? As I finish some of these comments, I'll get ready for my next round of questions, and I'm going to turn it over to you to just improv and do whatever you want, because I know fans are going to love to hear that. We got Giovanni from Brazil. Eric Gruber, snooping makes it sound creepy. Yeah, snooping each other's Facebook profiles and stuff. Bresbo says, hey, Eric, miss your shows this week. I hate that. I hated that too. You're the man. Thank you. I appreciate that. Jay's Tacos is saying audio is good. Good here. Everyone's getting good audio. Bobby Clipper is saying, hey, Warren and all. AI Gaming says, best advice I ever got was put the guitar down before you're ready. Practice can be jamming with the radio or in front of the TV, just making weird sounds with effects, but don't make it a job. Yeah, always have fun with it for sure. You know, as long as you're, when you're not having fun anymore, that's when it's time to reevaluate. And that's why I quit touring and stuff, because it was right. a job and I didn't want to do it. And it was a job that didn't pay very well.
Right.
You know, so no, done. No brainer. Let me see. Anything else I'm going to miss? Zach Thong says, what's up, Eric? Jumping over to your live show from Robert Baker's live show. Cool. Robert rocks for sure. This is cool. Jay's Taco says, like Jennifer Batten was saying, that E instead of the C was more correct. And the beat it solo, it just works. There you go. Liza says, George and Tony tears at the Sahara. A land without judgment says, yo. Hef is here. Hey, man. Says, hey, you guys. Hef is watching. Good to have you in the house. And Hef also says, yeah, music is the universal language. And that's why, you know, you get some people that don't understand a single word of a lyric, but they're singing along to it. And it's that common bond, right? You see these bands right. go to Japan and Europe and, you know, mm-hmm. Germany and all these different places. And they're even more popular over there, where some of the people don't actually even understand what they're listening to. Some, and they love it. Tone right. Morse is here and says, I don't know theory at all. If I did, it would keep me in a box. I like to stay unconventional. Yeah, and that's why sometimes I think I don't like to look at guitar as I sucked, and I still do to this point, in math. And I don't like to look at my guitar as a math quiz. And,
yeah.
And if I have to do an algorithm to figure it out, now, you know, hats off to these people that do that, the Steve Vais and all these people like that. Awesome. But I can't do it, and, you know, I struggle in math. It's not going to happen. The Gold Color says, you look up Sean Silas, phenomenal guitarist. You have no doubt about that. Love him to death. I think I like him more as a dad than I do as a guitar player, and his guitar playing rocks. I just lived through his family. Very cool dude.
Nice.
And I definitely love him as a guitar player. We're almost down to the bottom here. Tone War says, there you go. Hef says, if there's any one race, it's the human race. Yeah, and we need to improve on it as well, too. As a human race, there's probably some people looking at us from other galaxies and thinking that we're a little messed up.
Yeah, no doubt.
Yeah, we're the laughingstock if there is other life. Tone Wars, most of my best riffs are happy accidents that happen because of fishing around for lack of, yeah, exactly. And that can be like photography, anything. Happy accidents, you know, you just go with it if it happens, and if it's good, it's good. Renee Benton, what's up, Warren? Blessings to you. Jack Shea Martin, hey, Eric. I want to hear one of Warren's favorite go-to riffs, and we're going to do that in just a second. That's from Tone Wars. Ken McMahon says, tell Warren I said, hey, I just did. We grew up playing Van Halen together at the local store. Well, that's very, very cool.
Nice. Yeah, no doubt. Nice. Ken's an awesome player, man. He's like on that Steve I thing back in the early 90s. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? He's freaking phenomenal.
Mm. Wicked.
And a great person, man. He's good people.
Well, it's nice to hear, man. It's nice to have you here, Ken. Very, very happy. And I'm going to just highlight his comment, and we'll leave it right there. I'm going to turn it over to you. And, you know, I'm not trying to put you on the spot, but just so someone asked a moment ago, one of your favorite go-to riffs, and a lot of us have that. So show us maybe,
right.
show us a go-to riff that would do the first time you pick up your guitar, something that just is like your comfortable blanket, and then just do whatever you want to do.
That's like my go-to every time I pick up.
I like that.
Basically.
I love that, man.
Oh, thank you.
Very, very nice. Okay, so that's a nice little riff to warm you up, and, you know, you're checking your tone, that kind of stuff. Now, when you want to get downright silly and sassy.
Okay.
Silly and sassy. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to rephrase. Instead of silly and sass, that's just freaking badass.
Oh, thank you.
Dude. Now, what's the action like in that guitar? It's hard to tell from here.
It's actually terrible.
Is it?
You know what I mean? It's kind of high. It's this guitar was a... You remember those... Remember those Jackson Professional guitars? They was like really cheap.
Yeah.
Jackson had like 3 pickups in them and shit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I actually took all the pickups out. You know what I mean? I was working at a garage at the time, so I got some freaking spray paint. You know what I mean? Sanded the body down a little bit. You know, this is a pretty crappy job. I mean, I know it might look good on camera, but it looks like crap. But anyway, I always thought this was like the coolest guitar. You know?
Sure. Iconic.
And I know
iconic.
I could never afford like one of the, you know, the EVH series or any of that.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, you know, I'm going to just make it how I want it to look. So I actually painted this. And this pickup is the cheapest pickup out of a brand guitar that I'm not going to say. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to put nobody on the spot.
Sure.
I took this pickup, put it in here. And I thought of it like this. I always think of gear like this as far as pickups and things of that nature, you know. As far as this particular pickup, I thought of it like this. Eddie and them had crap to work with back in the day. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? They had crap. So this is 10 times better than what he had to work with. And, he made work what he had work. So that was my way of thinking as far as putting this particular pickup in this guitar. This pickup ain't worth $10.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? By said company. Okay?
Yeah.
But hey, it works for me. If I set my amp the tone that I wanted, you know what I mean? And you basically got to set it up around your pickups.
Sure.
And how your pickup sounds, man. And a lot of people don't realize that. So I set it up to where it sounds good with this pickup and where it sounds good for me to where the guitar responds the way that I want it to. That's how I set my tone.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So this guitar, it's not worth anything to anybody but me.
I love your honesty.
But I love it.
I love your honesty, how you said that, because I said, well, what's the action like? You could have said, well, I prefer it a little bit lower, whatever you have. Oh, it's pretty terrible.
Right. But, I mean, I do prefer low action.
Of course. Of course you would.
But this particular guitar is not like that.
No.
And I know how this guitar plays.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it's fine for me.
don't you think it's kind of a treat once in a while, too? Because I have a few guitars here, two guitars here. One's the boys. It's the Eastwood Airline that you might have seen me playing, that real retro looking George Gretchen style guitar.
Yeah.
And then, of course,
that thing sounds good.
It does, doesn't it? With single coil. Yes. They look like humbuckers, but they're single coil. And then the Line 6 guitar I was playing the last couple nights, the Variax.
Right.
And the action on both those guitars is considerably higher than, not super high, but higher that you notice it right away when you play. And I think it's nice because I've noticed when you play, when you play that guitar, you kind of focus a little bit more. And it's not like you're working necessarily harder, but you're just kind of subconscious in your mind. You know, you're not being spoiled by this, you know, millimeter high action.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. But for the speed that you do, I've seen you play a lot of guitars, you know, whether, you know, just some of these different clinics and things that you've done, or like the NAMM shows and the guitar amp shows and stuff like that.
Right.
Is it for speed, is it better for you to have the extremely low action and sometimes dampers and things like that?
It is for me. I like low action because I play a lot of legato. I'm not a really proficient picker at all.
Okay.
You know what I mean? I'm not. I'll be the first one to tell you right now. I'm not proficient at picking.
Okay.
So a lot of what I do is all, you know, like... you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't really pick a whole lot of that. I might have picked the string once. You know what I mean? So that's pretty much my style.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, I prefer low action, but this particular guitar, man, it kind of makes me work.
Yep.
So that when I do pick up a guitar with low action, it's like pretty much effortless.
A treat. It becomes a treat.
You know what I mean? And plus, I went up a gauge strings. I've been playing 10s now.
Yeah.
I remember we were talking about that on a previous show. And,
yeah.
I was like, they killed my hands, but I started playing with them. And then I went back to nines, and I was like, I'm bending these nines, like, way too far.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So it just kind of was, like, natural. It feels natural for me, I guess, now playing tens. So I kind of switched over.
Well,
I actually put these strings on there probably about 3 days ago. And, you know, I'm still getting used to them. But still, you know, I played this guitar with the nines on it. And I was just like, oh, no, that's not going to work.
No.
It's too wobbly.
I can just see, like, you have big hands as well, and I would imagine a really strong grip. And I would imagine, I mean, I honestly can't see you playing nines, to be honest with you. I think tens are probably the nice secret happy medium for you.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I played nines for years, man. Mm-hmm. Don't get me wrong. Yep. I did. I played nines for years. But here, as of late, like I said, it might have been a month or so ago, we were talking about this on your other show, and I was like, I can't play tens. They kill my hands.
Sure.
But, you know, I put them on here, and I'm just, because, like I said, I put some tens on something, on that vintage guitar that I have, and the Les Paul copy, you know, which is totally awesome, you know.
Sure.
But I put tens on it, man, and it just sounded so good. And then I played this, and it had nines on it. I was playing some of the you know what I'm saying? Doing stuff like that. And I was bending it all the way almost to the, you know.
Too far.
To the low E string. I was just like, oh, no, that's not going to do.
No.
I'm going to end up breaking one of these or something. So
yeah, you're strangling
the notes. I just put tens on everything and, you know, I'm going to just work with it.
Well, it's another happy accident. That's a happy accident. You discovered tens. Yeah.
Exactly.
So here's a question for you, and this is a perfect segue, too. So you got the iconic guitar there from, you know, Symbolize and Van Halen's first debut record. Tomorrow's the anniversary, and we talked about how Eddie, you know, how it impacted you. Let's play the what if game, and I'm going to ask this to everyone in the chat. You're more than welcome to comment as well, too, and I'll try to read some of the comments. What if you never heard that record? What if, you know, your parents said, I'm not letting you listen to this stuff, or what if it never happened? Where would you be today as a musician? I'm just curious to see.
What do you mean? What if that album never took place?
Yeah. What if you never heard Van Halen, the first record, or you weren't allowed to it, or just in another parallel universe that never happened? Where would you be as a musician?
I wouldn't be the player that I am right now.
Nice.
No way. Even though I don't play that style, that's not, you know.
Yep.
But at the same time, man, it was such an influence on every guitar player that I mentioned that I was influenced by.
Yep.
You know what I mean? It was such a big influence, man, that, you know, and a lot of those guys wouldn't exist either.
That's
if
true.
If it was not for.
That's true.
And that's just a fact of life, man. People just need to get over it.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, if Eddie wouldn't hit the scene, man, things wouldn't be how they are. There would still be guitar players, don't get me wrong, you know, because there are some great players, like for me, like Neil Sean, for instance.
Yep. Of course.
You know what I'm saying? It's things like, yes, he's an awesome player, you know, and I don't take anything away from him.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? But at the same time, Eddie brought this flair and this style and this finesse and that snarly growl of that Marshall, man, that, you know, nobody could, you know, there's people trying to duplicate that sound now, man, and you still don't got it.
Nope. That's right.
You know what I'm saying? And, you know, and I'm talking about that first album.
Of course.
You know, because his, you know, his sound changed from, you know, it seemed like from, I'll say,
Women and Children First.
Yeah, probably there. It started to change a little bit, and then so on and so forth. But that sound from that first album, man, it's just
insane.
It's rib crushing, man.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? It's heavier than any metal that I've heard ever. You know, it's just so freaking distinct, but at the same time, it's clarity.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I mean? And that's what probably caught my ear more than anything else. Just like one of my favorite solos, as far as Eddie is concerned, is that whole rendition of I'm the One. You know what I mean, man? That whole, you know, he's like. You know what I'm saying? Just little stuff like that, man. It's just like, you know, and nobody's duplicating that, man. That would have to be the greatest guitar solo, the greatest example of showmanship,
rhythm structure.
You know what I mean? Just in general, that that whole tune is freaking incredible.
Yeah, that's one that should be put on the plateau for bar, because there's a lot of people, you know, they sure these kids can copy Van Halen licks note for note in a lot of cases, but they try to play the rhythm to that. Just I'll take 10 guys and we'll make a contest out of it. And more than likely, not gonna happen.
That right there in itself, or just, you know, the riffing Little Dreamer or Ice Cream Man. Mm-hmm. So, you know what I'm saying?
All that stuff.
There's so many. You know what I'm saying? I mean, one of my other favorites is I'm on Fire.
Yes.
On Fire. That whole, you know, that was metal back, you know.
Sure was.
You know what I'm saying? That was heavier than, you know, anything that I heard at that particular point in time in my life. And even as a teenager, you know, walking up and down the street listening to that, man, that was heavy to me.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And it still is to this day. So, I mean, man, I could go on and on.
did you ever watch, this is a total segue, but did you ever watch the Simpsons cartoon show?
Yes.
Okay, I'm a retired Simpsons fan. I was religious about the Simpsons. And I mean, after 25 years of a cartoon, 28 years, whatever it is, it gets old, right?
Right.
But you remember the episode where Homer goes back in time, and basically, I think it was like something with a toaster or whatever, he goes back in time, and then, you know, he steps on don't do anything, don't change nature, whatever, and he steps on a bug, and he kills the bug, and it changes the future. Right? So imagine now if Van Halen, that just didn't happen. If the first record never happened, Van Halen never happened, and you said, you know, how he changed guitar, but let's take our guitarist. You would not have amplifiers like we have today. You would not have pickups like we have today. You would not have tremolo systems like we have today.
No.
There's just, I mean, that list goes on and on and on. It's like a little stone in a pond that just ripples. It's not all Eddie. And people are going to say, oh, there's other people that contributed. Yes.
I mean, they set the standard for that genre as far as what came after.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Everything in the 80s, all those bands, the way they dressed.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? They got that from Van Halen. I mean, from the band, you know, David Lee Roth. You know, I mean, you know, I mean, look at Rat and look at, you know.
Poison.
Look at Poison. Look at Dokken. Look at all these guys was wearing the. You know, David Lee Roth started
Motley
that
Crue.
Spandex or ski pants or whatever you want to call them.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? And then next thing you know, here's, you know, every other band from that era was wearing this stuff.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? And the cut-off gloves and the ripped T-shirts. And, you know, even, you know, you had older bands, you know, copying the fashion. You know what I mean? You had Kiss, you know, like, you know, they were copying the fashion too, man.
That's
so it was just like... You know, it was more than just the music, man. They were a lifestyle.
That's right. That's right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. So, and they were our spokespeople for us young, especially guys as young teenagers. You know, they were our heroes and our spokespeople. Like, okay, life is according to Van Halen for us as 12, 13, 14-year-old kids. And whatever they did, that's what we wanted to be. We wanted to be those larger-than-life rock stars, you know?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, I know, you know, I love to play music. Don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. But I always looked at myself as, I'm going to be like that. Especially after I saw it live.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I didn't get to see him with David Lee Roth. I got to see him with Sammy. But nevertheless, I got to see... You know, something that
was Van Halen, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So it was nonetheless still, you know, impressionable.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So yeah, most definitely, man. I don't know where my life would be without that.
It'd be a different place.
That right there was the main thing that made me want to do what I do. That's why I made this guitar, because I know I don't, like I said, I don't play like him, but. You know, he was always just the coolest. It was just always cool looking and awesome to hear. You know what I mean? And I still, you know, still got, you know, mad respect, man. I always do.
Yeah.
And I listen to that, you know, I still listen to that first CD or cassette or whatever it is that you have.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I listen to it all the time. You know, listen to it all the time.
Yeah.
You know, even to this day. So, and that's never going to stop.
That's right. I'm in a very happy place in my life too because of that. You know, had it not been for Van Halen, and Van Halen wasn't my first band that really got me into music. It was AC/DC I liked and Kiss, probably Kiss first. Loved Kiss to death, and I still have a passion for them. You know, they're certainly not the world's most gifted musicians. They can hold their own and probably have some licks that would surprise us. But right. what they've done was cool. They inspired a lot of us. So Kiss, AC/DC, then Van Halen come around, and it's just like, okay, now it's a game changer. So, you know, I owe a lot of happiness in my life to that music, and if it didn't happen, we wouldn't be here talking tonight. So it's I'm very right. happy for that, and I've met absolutely. Cool people like you because of it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And I can remember, you know, getting Kiss Alive too, man, and, you know, sitting there with the record, you know, having it folded open and
yep.
looking at the fire and the smoke and,
yep.
you know, looking at them on stage and listening to, you know, Detroit Rock City and, you know, and stuff like that, man. Like I said, I was the little kid that was just, I was different than everybody else, man. I was the only little black kid that was, you know, totally into the, like, you know, the rock stuff. So
yeah,
I'm kind of by myself a lot. Hey. And I kind of used my imagination a whole lot.
You had to.
But it was all good, man. I wouldn't trade it for anything in the world.
And speaking of using your imagination, let's go back to that Kiss record. And this is what's so cool. And this is what kids just don't get today. So you look right. at that double fold-out record, and right. you're reading. And sometimes they had like, some would come with some trading cards and stuff like that too, which was very, very right. cool. But you would listen to that record. And before you got up, you know, you'd be reading who produced it, who is the engineer, where it was recorded, right. where it was mixed at. Those are the cool mm-hmm. things. And then, okay, well, I got to get up and flip the record, go over and flip it. You come back, you're reading that album right. again. You're looking at the fire again. You're looking mm-hmm. over at Ace. It wasn't an experience, right? You know?
Absolutely. And that whole thing was an experience.
You
yes.
didn't have pages to turn. Yeah. You didn't have, like, you know, you weren't texting or sending a picture on Instagram. You no. were consumed in no. this record.
No, and I remember, you know, especially with the Kiss stuff, man, I was a big Kiss fan, too. I used to take my milk money from school and go to the store and buy Kiss cards. I had every Kiss card.
Me too. Not my milk money, but yeah, the Kiss cards.
Yeah, I had every Kiss card, and if you turned them over, it made a poster.
Yes.
I had every last one of those. You know what I'm saying? And then yep. for my birthday, I think I was turning 8 or 9. My mom got me a... Remember how your parents used to get you stuff with your name ironed on the back of your shirt?
Yeah, that's so, you know, so bad.
She got me a yellow Kiss, you know, had my name on the back of it, and an iron on of the Destroyer cover.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? When I was like 9 years old and shit, and I worked at school, you know, of course, everybody made fun of me and shit.
Yeah.
You know? But, you know, and then she ordered me like these special posters.
Nice.
You know what I'm saying? And they came in a tube.
Yep, yep.
You know, and I was just like, you know, and I had them in my room and shit, and it was just like, you know, mom really knows what I like. You know what I'm
That's
saying?
That's a great she, mom.
She gives a damn. You know what I mean? So
I love your mom. I don't even know her.
But yeah, man, I was definitely into the music even from an early age. I just always had that imagination.
Yeah.
Or I would throw, you know, my mom would let me, she'd let me put her stereo speakers out on our back porch. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And she put the Kiss records on. And then once again, I go break a stick off a tree that looked like a V guitar.
Yep.
And I'd spit red Kool-Aid and shit, you know.
Oh, that's wicked.
You know what I mean? I'm serious, man. It was just like, you know, I was totally into it. Totally into it.
I got to share two Kiss stories with you that are really funny. One, because you mentioned the Kiss cards. So
sure.
When I grew up in a real, real small town. I shouldn't say a town, like in a country, like it was not even a town, it was just out in the country. My neighbors were like 300 yards away. But I would go into the city, and my sisters lived in the city. So I get to go sleep overnight at my sister's house in the city. You know, it was a big thing. And,
right.
you know, so that was a big deal. And there was a variety store within walking distance. And I was too young, but my sister would say, yeah, go ahead and go to the store. I go down there with a couple of dollars. I buy some Kiss cards. I come back and I collect some pop bottles, whatever. And I take the pop bottles back, get some money back, and I go buy some more Kiss cards.
Chewing
the bubble gum on the way home. And then I'd go back again and I would say to the lady that ran the store, I said, I'm buying the last two packs. Can I have that box, like the little display box that came in?
Right, right.
And I just wanted the display box. So I got that. So that's kind of a geek out story.
Wow.
And I had all the
sets.
Cool. And then another small story is, you know, when you buy like your wife or your mom or anyone like bad gifts for presents, here's an example mm-hmm. of, you know, like you buy your mom a blender. It's like maybe
right.
she wants a blender, but, you know, don't buy a blender or don't buy a broom for your mom for a birthday gift, right?
Right, right, right.
So it was my mom's birthday. And my dad and I said, let's get her a scientific calculator. Okay. I think it might have been my idea. Totally stupid, 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 stupid idea. But so we gave her the scientific calculator from Radio Shack, and it must have been $100, you know, back in the day for a calculator mm-hmm. that's, you know, you have it now as an app that's free with ads. And so we give it to her, and she's like, yeah, this is what I always wanted. But she, you know, come from her son, so I'm going to treasure it. And one day, a friend of mine on the school bus, I didn't have any Kiss, nothing, like anything. It was kind of hand-me-downs. And the records, like one of my friends had Kiss records that were scratched, so they'd give me their record. So a friend has this cool yellow T-shirt with a Kiss iron-on on it, Kiss Alive 1. And I'm like, I want that. What can I do to get that shirt? I'll trade you something. What do you got? I got a scientific calculator. And I traded my mom's scientific calculator.
Wow.
And so next day, a couple days later, I'm wearing a Kiss shirt in the house, which is like, okay, where'd you get a Kiss shirt? Have you seen my calculator?
Wow.
No. So I'm sorry, Mom. God, you know, God rest her soul. She's no longer with us, but I still have her I have her calculator. I kept it in her honor. So
gotcha.
So there you go. But anyways,
no doubt.
That's
no
crazy.
Doubt.
But we did crazy things. That's Kiss fans.
Absolutely.
Kiss fans are just nuts. That's the bottom line.
Absolutely.
So let's talk NAMM. So
sure.
NAMM fell apart for you last minute, and I know a lot of people are looking forward to seeing you this year, and you were diehard to be there this year. So let's so forget about what happened. It doesn't matter what happened to you. 2019 is going to be here quicker than we want to admit it anyways. What are your plans for NAMM 2019, and tell us what you're looking forward to.
2019, I'm looking forward to, you know, just meeting up with some of these reps at these companies, you know, that were looking forward to meeting me in 2018, you know what I mean? And just, you know, just keeping the relationships that I have with a lot of the, you know, the great people I've met out in California every time that I go, you know what I mean? I can't say enough about, you know, like Greg Mara and, you know, Lonnie Spector. Lonnie Spector does the AMP show out in Van Nuys. I don't know if you know Lonnie, but
I know the name, only the name. That's all I know is the name.
And let's see here. And Oscar Jordan. Okay. Oscar Jordan is the editor of Vintage Guitar Magazine.
Okay.
He's really put a foot forward trying to get me out there or just, you know what I mean, just doing anything that they can to actually help. You know what I mean? Then there's Terry Lauderdale. He's a great guitar player. He plays a lot of Van Halen stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these people are, you know, awesome beyond being musicians or trying to do something for me. They're just good people in general.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And so just being able to go out there and, you know, and then, you know, like I said, with, you know, Line 6 and, you know, a lot of those people, man, to just go above and beyond, you know, for little old me, man, is, you know, just, like I said, started making videos on Facebook. So,
and there you go.
I'm just looking forward to going to NAMM and actually being able to sit down and play. This year, that was one of my main goals, is not to be so shy.
Mm-hmm. And we talked about this. Yep.
You know, and just kind of open up a little bit, man. Go out there and play. That's what you do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of times I'll find myself walking around or just shying away from playing.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? But this year I was making it a point to, you know, sitting down and playing and you know, just meeting more people, you know what I'm saying? Because that's what it's all about. I'm more interested in working with these companies. I'm more interested in that than being, quote unquote, this, you know, famous guitar player.
Sure.
You know what I mean? I could care less about that.
Yep.
Those days are gone.
Yeah, the industry has changed that way with mediums that we have available. You can be as successful now and more successful and safer and have family ties and a comfort zone by doing it, by producing videos for people and that kind of stuff. Here's a good example. So let's say I'm prospective XYZ company and I make amplifiers. Give me a 2-minute pitch what Warren Hughes is as a guitar player and what I can do for your guitar company or your
exactly.
Give us a Cole's notes about you. What would you say to someone? So Warren, what are you about? Well, tell me a little bit about yourself as a musician.
What?
So
as
yeah,
a musician. Yeah. I'm all about the music.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's what's the most important thing here. Is, you know, once again, I'm gonna say it. It's the vibrations that you're giving out or the frequencies. You know what I mean? That's what's touching people. That's where you get. You know, sometimes you hear something or you hear somebody sing or you hear somebody play something and you get those cold chills.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? That's what it's all about. You know what I mean? So that's basically what I'm here for, man. That's what I was put on this planet for.
Yep.
I wasn't put on this planet to work a 9-to-5 that society says I had to work or society said I had to go to school 4 years for. You know what I mean? That's not why I was put on this planet.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Some of us are.
I was put on this planet to share what I was blessed with.
Yeah, that's right.
And that's it. I wasn't put here for nothing else.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Of course, you know, we're parents and we have children. And of course, you know, we're as parents, our job as parents is to teach our kids to survive once we're not here anymore.
I know.
That's our job.
That's right.
It's not our job to spoil our kids to death with every materialistic thing that we can give them. You know what I'm saying? I'm more satisfied knowing that my kids can stand on their own 2 feet after I'm gone from here.
Learn how to cook, way, learn how to work, learn how to build.
I mean, you're not worrying about anything, but at the same time, you don't have to.
That's
because
right.
You know, you did your job.
Yeah.
You know, but more than anything, man, it's like I said, it's all about the music for me and projecting that and taking people's minds off of that, you know, off of that little bit of worry or trouble or whatever they're stressing about that day. If I take your mind away from that.
That's beautiful.
For the small amount of time that I'm doing what I do, then, hey, I did my job.
Isn't that rewarding when you get some comments? You know, like, I'm going through a real tough time right now and your stuff helped me. That's like, you know, it doesn't pay the bills, but it certainly makes your heart warm.
Absolutely. That's worth more to me than, you know, paying a bill.
I agree.
You know what I'm saying?
I agree.
There's more satisfaction out of somebody telling me, you know, they're just floored by what I do. And
yeah.
I don't see, you know, the thing is, and I'm sure you get this too. I don't see what the big deal is about what I do.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? I don't hear what you're hearing.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
If that makes sense.
No, it does 100%.
I don't hear what everybody else hears. I'm just doing what I love to do.
I agree 100%.
You know, so if what I'm doing is taking you to that place, then hey, thank you for the compliment. And, you know, I'm glad to be here to be able to take your mind to that place.
It is hard to accept a compliment sometimes. It's hard because
right.
You're like, okay, well, why do I deserve this? You know?
Right, right.
Yeah,
right.
I like it. But yeah. I think for sure, for you, and I understand, like, you had the confidence issue, and a lot of people, that's a struggle they go through. Even when
right.
I started doing this show, and I'm not going to lie, I'll be 100% honest, even every night going live with you tonight, there's
right.
the pre-show jitters, and it's getting better and better all the time. But,
right.
If I said, oh, well, I'm calm as a cucumber, cool as a cucumber, and no, I'm lying, man. I get nervous with it. And I think
right.
you need to, nerves are always a good thing. And I think the day that you lose nerves, whether you're performing on stage in front of thousands or 100 or 10,
right.
The day that you lose nerves, you need to reevaluate yourself. But, you know, I I'm not trying to give you advice. You don't really need advice, but this is from friend to friend, something I want to see
sure.
you kick ass at NAMM next year, and Junior and I are going to be there with you for sure. But just
absolutely.
Be there. Look like you're supposed to be there. You know, like these guys that are gate crashers that get in behind concerts all the time? They get
right,
they
right,
get in
right.
to see the bands because they look like they're supposed to be there, whatever. So look like you're supposed to be there. When you're there, be there. Own it. You're going to own it. Your playing speaks for itself. So you just have
thank
to
you.
You just have to say, okay, look, okay, I know I'm here. This is my chance. You may shred. You may make some bad notes. Once you do it, you can't change the bad notes or the good notes, whatever.
Right, exactly.
You know,
right.
Your personality will win you over for sure. Just find a way, you know, find that happy place that lets you speak instead of being the
right.
window shopper going from booth to booth to booth. Get in there
right.
and shake hands. Bring something that's really cool. Just like I was telling Greg Morrow when you were talking about Greg. He was going to
mm-hmm.
be releasing his album. And I said, hey, bring a wristband, one of those, you know, those elastic wristbands that have like the
right.
MP3s on it, and give it to
right.
your people. And they're going to be,
mm-hmm.
if they like it, they're probably going to be wearing it all NAMM. They're going to go home. What's this thing I've been wearing all weekend? Oh, the
right.
Greg Mara, or it's Warren Hughes. Let's check it out. Pop it
right.
in my computer. Boom. Right?
I actually made, I actually got some business cards made. And
yeah.
I taped a piece of candy to every single freaking
dude,
you know what I'm saying?
Dude, that's
because,
good.
I mean, you know, you're at NAMM all day, you're talking to people all day.
Sore throat.
You know what I'm saying? And, you know, it's like, hey, man, shit, here, you know, here's my card. Here go a piece of candy, you know what I'm saying? So there was things I did, but like I said, man, it was such a letdown. I don't think I've been that disappointed and ever since I was a little kid. I almost cried, man. I was just like,
I know.
Man.
I felt it for you. I felt it for you for sure.
Man,
but
it was
it was channel
such
that.
A letdown. You know, and then have, you know, certain things happen, you know what I'm saying? It's
yeah.
just like, are you freaking serious?
Yeah.
But you know, and it's like, you know, that's fine. You know, I kind of just let that go. I was just like, you know what? I'm not even going to get mad. I started to get mad and I started to say things and I posted some things.
Yep.
And I was like, you know what? Nope, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to take it down right now. You know what I'm saying? Because
yeah.
they know what they did.
Yep.
And we're just going to leave it at that because,
yeah.
you know, there's always next year.
That's right. And it's going
to
be good.
You know what I mean? There's always next year, and I've made enough connections to where everything will be fine.
Yep.
You know, so, and that's where I'm going with it. All I can do now is just keep what I'm doing. And, like I said, keep in contact with these people.
Yep.
And of course, you know, I'm trying to get this album finished. There's been a lot of changes, man. I started to go super heavy metal, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And you know, after evaluating some things, I'm like, that's not who I am.
Okay.
You know, that's not who I am. I love to play stuff like that, but it's not who I am.
Okay.
And it's always been like, I've tried to always appease.
Yeah. Appease the masses.
I tried to appease and try to keep up.
Yep.
You know what I mean? But now I'm at the point to where, like, I'm not doing that anymore.
So where are you going with it?
I'm going to play how I want to play. And it seems like things are more natural.
Okay.
Of me playing how I actually want to play instead of trying to play like, you know, the... you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's not who I am.
Okay.
You know, I can do that. Yes, of course.
So show us who you are. Show us who you are.
There are 1,000 guys out there that are doing the same thing.
Yeah.
And they're doing it a lot better than I am. You know, so I'm just like, you know what? You guys go ahead and do that. I'm going to stick to what's true to me. And that's just how I'm going to do it. So a lot of the stuff I'm writing now is more of like that favorite riff that you told me to play
okay.
earlier. More laid back, man. I mean, I'm not, you know, I'm not 17 or 18 years old anymore.
Nothing
to
prove.
I don't have to prove how fast I can play.
Yes.
You know, so now it's more of a groove thing instead of a speed thing.
I like that. I like that. Yeah, we don't have anything to prove once we've been doing this as long as we have.
Right, exactly.
Very well said. We're going to jump back to the comments here in a second, and we'll wrap up here in a couple of minutes.
Sure.
But one thing I'm really looking forward to next year, if you would do me the honor, is because Junior and I are going to be there next year, let's find each other very early into NAMM. I want to go for dinner with you. And
absolutely.
Let's go out for dinner, have a really good meal, something nice and greasy.
Right.
You know, let's have some good food and let's talk about a NAMM strategy. And I want to see you ace it. And I want to be that guy, 6 months down the road saying, I knew him when he was on my show, you know, now he's a superstar. So
absolutely.
I want to do that.
Most definitely. We are going to do that.
All right. Sure. Perfect. So let me see. Bruzbro was saying, which part of West Virginia did you live? That's where I lived. FNAF Gamer says, turns out the problem with my 5150 microstack was the battery is very low. That can do it. Fizzy. Pipsy James, or if I'm getting it right, says, I remember Venoman Music, Warren. I got a Fretless Wonder Gibson SG there from them.
Oh, yeah, I remember Venoman's Music Store. It was in Springfield, Virginia.
Okay.
I do remember them.
Okay.
They always had like the... they always had all the Kramers and the Charvels. You know what I mean? Remember back in the day, if you bought a Jackson, you really had to buy a Jackson. There was no lower line.
No.
You know what I'm saying? Of Jackson or a Kramer. But anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, that's good. Like nowadays, you can buy them at, Future Shop and Best Buy and Sears. I'm not sure. I'm crazy about that.
Right.
So your buddy Ken says he's glad to see you on here for sure. Scott Tucker says, hello, EVH Gear TV and Warren, much respect to you, sir. Keep melting those frets. And lots of comments on Sean Silas as well, too. So Sean, obviously, is well loved here as well. And this is cool. Nemtal says, Warren, you're no cookie cutter. You rule. and Hefner's from Mississippi. Don Shepard says, Eric, music transcends language. Agreed. And your buddy Ken says, thanks and happy for all. Liza says, I don't even play guitar, but there's just something about it. Thank goodness my mom and dad raised me on rock and roll and introduced me to Jimi Hendrix and Jimmy Page. Great influences there for sure. Tone
no
Wars,
doubt.
Very cool. Nice legato technique. That's from Tone Wars as well. Craig Grundle says, I actually like higher action. Cool. And that's good. If you can play with it, man, go for it. And you can certainly bend under it. And Craig's one of these anomalies too, that can play, and like you as well, play in high action and shred.
No doubt. Yeah, Craig's awesome.
He says, I can get better grip on the strings and have less string noise with higher action, just easier to naturally mute while we're playing. Very good point, Craig. That's something we could probably all learn from for sure. And another plus for higher action, that's from Curtis Murata. Jay's Talkers guitarist says, this is honestly, in all my years, the first time I've heard people say they prefer higher action. Right on. Yeah, it's kind of neat. When you go to it, it's not like you change all your guitars, but when you play one, it's a bit of a mindset that you get into, and when you go back to your other guitarist, it's like, oh, here's my candy. Gold Color says, how is Craig first, St. Petersburg And here at Sean Salas is his friend as well, too. Sorry, I'm mumbling a little bit. And more sustained, and also more sustained in general. Okay, good to know, Craig. Thank you for that tip. Okay, here's a question for you from Steve. Says, Warren, would you prefer passive or active pickups?
Passive.
Okay, yep.
I'm old school, man.
There you go. Yeah.
Yeah, so.
I do too. I've had a couple EMG guitars, whatever, like the PRS Torero, right, stuff like that. It's neat. It has its own voice, but I'm the passive guy as well too.
Yeah, it's a little too sharp for me, man.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's just missing something. Yeah. Let me see here. Last few questions here. Mark Taylor says, I think nearly every player was directly or indirectly influenced by Eddie, whether they admit it or not. And I agree 100%. I've seen so many people come through the show here from every genre of music, country, rock, everything. It's like, you actually were inspired by Eddie Van Halen in country? Sure it was, you know?
Right.
Yeah, it transcends. Mara Music Greg says, totally know what you're saying, Warren. Love you, bro. So you have mad respect from someone who you have mad respect for.
Absolutely, man. Greg's good people.
Yes.
He's awesome.
He is. I had so much fun with him. He was very, right, very fun. And we've talked a lot since the show, too. Tone War says, On Fire is my lady jam. Craig Reynolds, Eddie is number one branching point for 80s players, and Yngwie is the number two branch. Most of the best rock and metal players derive from those two camps. There you go. There's two forks in the road, and I agree with that. Totally, you know? Look at the Jason Beckers, the Marty Friedmans, the Paul Gilberts in one kind,
right,
of camp. You know, and over here you've got your Eddie Van Halens, your Vito Bradas, your, you know, it's just so many, right?
Right, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah, well, very well said, Craig. 80s were the best era for music and movies for that matter, says Liza. And I agree, I'm stuck in the 80s, and I'm not afraid to, I remember I joked today on Mike Himmel's post. Mike posted a picture with his real long hair. And he goes, you know, throwback to the 80s. And I said, nothing wrong with the 80s, man. I'm still stuck there and I'm not leaving, you know?
Right.
I'm
right,
staying there.
And see, I remember him when he had that long hair.
I bet you do. Yeah, that was the scene for you.
He had this JB player. Remember JB player?
I do.
He had this JB player. It was had a reverse headstock and he had M&M stickers all over it.
Okay.
Like, you know, like the candy?
Yep.
But man, he was freaking killing that Van Halen, man. I'm telling you right now. He ain't doing nothing new, man. He freaking killed it back then, and he's
still doing it.
He's doing the same now. So yeah, he's been doing that for a long time, but he was freaking flawless with it. So
I'm not sure if you saw the episode where I was talking with Mitch Malloy. There's a really cool Mike Himmel reference. Mike Himmel was doing some work with Mitch Malloy. And so he's at Mitch's place and the phone rings. It's and Mitch answers the phone and it's Eddie Van Halen on the phone. And Eddie's saying something to Mitch Malloy, whatever, and Mitch goes to Mike, it's Eddie, like this. You know, it's pretty cool. Because Mike actually told me that story. Mike says, ask him about the phone call. So I did, and he confirmed it. Last few comments here, and then we're going to say goodnight. Kevin Landorf, it says, hi, everyone. Talking to Kevin before the show. And Kevin, keep up working on Kevin is just migrating into lead guitar, and he's doing a good job. And he had a friend ask him to do it. So, and the cool thing is, the very first time he did it, he posted a video on Facebook, and that's either sink or swim.
Right.
And he swam, man. More power to you.
Yeah, no doubt. That's
Please
good.
Keep it up. Please keep it up.
No
and,
doubt.
And guys, you know, if you see someone out there that's doing something, recognize it. Don't just scroll down through the feed. And I don't believe in necessarily giving false praise if it's not the good. It's like, but recognize things. And if it's good, like he did, I wanted to recognize it because I was proud of him. You know,
Absolutely.
He had balls to post that video on Facebook and he played well.
Yeah.
So more power to you. Yeah. More power to you. Mr. C, 5150 says, EVH is the coolest guy ever. Agreed. Totally agree from Jay's Tacos. AI Gaming says, I saw Van Halen in Toronto in 2007 at the very beginning of the tour. Raw sounded great, was all downhill after that. Yeah, it's a little different. He never was the greatest singer, but, you know, it's age affects us all. Renee Benton says, as I've often stated, there are only three guitarists that changed the approach to modern rock guitar. Modern rock beginning in 1970, Hendrix's death, only three going to current day Hendrix. And then it looks like he got cut off a little bit. Van Halen and someone else, but he got cut off. Oh, Van Halen and Malmsteen. Yeah, I can agree with that. Hendrix to Clapton to Eddie to Yngwie to Petrucci to Abbasi. That's from Tone Wars. Yeah, there's your migrations. Great interview from Mr. C5150. Thank you. Appreciate it. That's all because we have a great guest here this evening. Abbasi to Sean Silas gave Tobin Sean Silas's Bourne's volume pot. I have one of those here as well, too. They're very cool. and Tone Wars loves your red Kool-Aid story.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Liza says music saves a lot of us every day. I cannot imagine life without music. And really, there's a lot of things in life that we can go without, but music would be a real tough one. You know, as long as we have food and shelter and something to listen to, I think life is good. You know, it doesn't necessarily have to have a ton of money in your bank account as long as you're safe and secure and you have something to listen to. Phil Keege, another great talent. I think we're just about down at the bottom of the list. Humbucker Lover's just jumping in from the Guitar News Network, saying hi to everybody. Who have I missed? Have I missed anyone else? Mike Francis, hey guys, sorry late, playing with the Variax. I don't blame you for that. Ron Bain says, I'm stuck in the 80s when music was music. Thomas Santiago says, great show, Eric. Mike Francis, Mr. Hughes is awesome, keep rocking. Eamon Ryan says, hey Warren, I see you're playing on my Facebook group, sharing guitar licks. Great playing, dude. And I
thank you, and
I have the same birthday as EVH, January 26th. That's from Ron Bain. And FNF Gamer says, great stream, I'm loving it. I want to ask you as we wrap up here, I'm a huge fan, I'm a fanboy of your music, and I obviously I'm just a fan of you in general as a person, and I think we can all learn a lot from you. What's next for you? What is your goal or goals in
2018 is to get this album released.
Right on.
You know what I mean? I'm actually going to be recording more with Jim Dofka. He's a studio engineer, and then I'll be having this mixed out and have a friend out in San Francisco that's going to do the mastering. So, you know, I hope to get that all wrapped up this year and get that out by the time NAMM gets here, and I have something to give to the people.
Nice. So that's the goal. You're going to get that something done music wise. Hand it out to key people at NAMM.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Or to everybody.
Of course, I mean? Of course.
I just wanna get this done. It's something that's long overdue. So
that's good, man.
So that's where the work is, and of course, you know, helping any of these companies that want their instruments heard.
Yes.
I'm more than willing to demonstrate how good of a instrument or piece of merchandise that you make.
Certainly. And these days, product endorsements, when it comes to, you know, representing a product, people like to, you know, to watch these videos and see honest reviews and, you know, either falling flat on your face or having a successful demo or whatever, learning it as you go. People like that kind of stuff. And I can see you being very, very, I can see you being an ambassador to many brands. So I wish you the best with that.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
Awesome. And
thank you for having me. I really appreciate it. This has been awesome.
Dude,
and
I'm
and
thrilled.
Like you said, man, I can't wait to meet face to face, man. We're going to
dinner.
We're going to hang.
We're going to hang.
That's what I call it.
Dinner for sure. And you're going to get a kick out of Junior, man. He's going to love you. He's going to have you in stitches. For sure he is. He's going to have you laughing your ass off.
Man. No doubt. But I'm looking forward to it.
Dinner, hang out, then strategize. We're going to get you. NAMM, you're going to own it. There's going to be people wearing Warren Hughes t-shirts at NAMM 2020.
That's right.
2020. They're going to be wearing Warren Hughes shirts. There you go. But 2019, you're going to set the place on fire. That's going to be great. Not literally, of course. We don't want any fires.
Yep.
Awesome, buddy.
Listen,
thank you so very much for gracing us with your greatness this evening. It's positive vibes going into the weekend, and just an honor, man. It's a real honor, and this is not going to be the first and last time you're coming on this show.
Anytime, man. I'm always available. You just let me know.
Awesome. There's a lot people can take from you and learn from you, and that's not just music. First and foremost, I think they can learn a lot about respect and happiness from you, and number two, music talent is the icing on the cake.
Absolutely. Thank you, man. I appreciate it.
Awesome. Everyone, thank you so very, very much for everyone watching in the chat. And if you'd be so kind, if any of you would like to do this and just kind of share this video on your platforms, whether it be Twitter or Facebook, just grab the link that you're watching right now and share that. It'd be great to get more people to discover myself and Warren, the show, all this kind of stuff. Sean Silas has just popped in. We cannot say goodbye without recognizing Sean Silas.
What up, Sean?
Sean is here, buddy.
I was looking forward to meeting Sean at NAMM, too.
You'll meet him next year. And talk about cool dad. Talk about cool dad.
Right.
And then he can play. So that's great. So, Sean, we're going to see you next year for sure. Sean, come out for dinner with us. There we go. All right?
Yeah.
Let's all get together for dinner. Everyone, as Sean, Curtis Murata says, have a great weekend, everyone. Thanks for keeping this place positive. Your show, great show, Warren and Eric. Thank you so much. And, Sean, try to watch this one back. There's some great stories from Warren, and there's going to be many more. as I told you, I had a lot of questions left over from Blue Saraceno the other night, which means return visits. I've got a lot of questions left over for you, which means return visit. So we'll work out something towards the summer time and get you back, and we'll have some fun. I'm going to say goodbye to you off the air, so don't go away yet. Everyone, have a kick-ass weekend, and be safe out there. Love each other, and have a great weekend. We will see you very soon. Cheers.
I am now on Patreon. If you enjoy my content and wish to support my channel and what I do, then please check out my Patreon page at patreon.com/EVHGearTV. Your support assures the continued growth of this channel and a fun community in which to share our love for Van Halen, music gear, and much more.
Hey, my name is Eric, and I'm playing the Frankenstrat guitar.
Video production services provided by Design 39 Media. Visit design39media.com for all your website, photography, and video production needs.